Hello, everybody. Hope you can hear me. We're streaming. Any problems with the sound or anything, just write it in the comments. Then I can adjust it slightly. This is the first one of these live streams where I've got a guest, and it's a great pleasure for me to have Graeme Flowers here. So before we get into the chat, we're going to start off with some music, and we're going to play Body and Soul.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it gives me great pleasure to invite Graeme here. So anybody got any questions for later, or anyone want to chip in or anything, just feel free to type away in the comments section in the live chat.
Be kind.
What's your earliest musical memory? How did you? What's the first thing you can think about in your music? Is it maybe a song or something you heard on the radio? Or what's the first thing that kind of made you grab an interest in music or anything like that?
Well, they're probably two separate answers, really. That I think the first thing I remember actually was getting a Walkman from my parents.
Okay.
Back in the 90s or maybe the 80s. And getting kind of cassettes from, like, I guess 80s music, you know, Spandau Ballet, Duran Duran, all that sort of stuff. So even though that's so far away from what we've just been playing, it's kind of, yeah, that was the music of the time, I guess. And then I think we got a keyboard in the house when I was probably about 10 or something, like a Yamaha PSR or something or other, and just messing around like that on that, you know, recording things and stuff and just trying stuff out with no knowledge at all, really.
Brilliant. It's pretty similar to how I started again. Yeah, my parents have got a keyboard and I started messing around. I forgot to tell people last month that one of the things I used to play over and over, I couldn't walk past the keyboard without playing Axel F.
I know. And that was on last night as well. I noticed on TV and it's still like, wow, that's amazing. I used to know all the words to that movie.
It's brilliant. So what was the first instrument you played? So the first instrument was the keyboard, then I take it.
Yeah, but I mean, this is messing around with demos and stuff like that with no knowledge of any sort of harmony or what notes were really at all.
Right.
But then I think for some reason at the music room at school had a trumpet in the corner. It wasn't like it really sort of spoke to me or anything, like I really wanted to play it, but I just seemed to sort of have it in my hand and went home. I asked for it, but...
you didn't take it away.
No, I didn't just take it away, and I took it home, and it sort of, I was playing kind of whatever nursery rhymes or, you know, tune a day type stuff. I think someone maybe gave me a book of like Glenn Miller tunes, but like really basic stuff. So I'm sort of, you know, fumbling away and like with no range at all and just sort of trying to get that together.
Brilliant. So you were, to start with, you were self-taught with it. You just took it home and you started to mess around.
Yeah, but I think there was a trumpet teacher at school and kind of, yeah, I wouldn't say I was entirely self-taught, but I did mess around for the first couple of weeks. And then I think I sort of showed an interest in it and then kind of got some lessons at school. And then Northamptonshire County Music Service is a great music service. And I think I quickly sort of got into some of the sort of lower levels and sort of, you know, beginner bands within that system, probably about when I was like 12 or 13, I think.
And this was Northampton. Did you grow up in Northampton?
Yeah, grew up in Northampton, just right in the middle of the UK, you know, sort of had a fairly normal upbringing, really. And actually was playing a lot of football and doing a lot of athletics and stuff like that. And was quite good at that, and my dad was a real sort of avid football fan, and I think it came to a bit of a toss-up on a Saturday morning: is it going to be football practice or is it going to be like band practice, if you like? And I think I was just a bit fed up of rolling around in the mud
on a wet, cold,
February morning, especially in the winter. It's like, oh, why do I have to do this? Maybe I'll just go to a warm band room and play the trumpet.
Yeah, exactly. And plus, I guess you can play the trumpet all your life, but if you're going to get into sport, it's a very short-lived career, isn't it? Like, even at the highest level.
I mean, you could argue that maybe you make more money in that short amount of time, but yeah, you're right. I think footballers are probably done by mid-30s, you know, whereas hopefully we've got a bit longer.
yeah. Great. So so you started playing at the school. When did you start to play with other people? Did you start playing in, like... kind of ensembles in the school, or was it outside school? Was it kind of like
I feel like it was more outside school, but I mean, this is a long time ago, but definitely county Northamptonshire County Music Service was something that, and still is, a really good organization. And
right,
I think I got into the county wind band, but they'd have like county wind band 1, 2, and 3.
Right.
And three would
it's
be
like the first division, second division,
exactly. And I was definitely in the third division, just like not knowing what I was doing. I remember having a really vivid light bulb moment when I realized what a key signature was. And I hadn't been using a key signature before. I think I'd just been playing everything in my version of C.
Yeah.
And then I suddenly realized, what are those squiggles at the start of the line?
And then it took you 30 years to realize you don't need those anyway.
we're playing jazz.
What are key signatures?
But then I think they had an orchestra there, and then they had big bands and stuff like that. So again, the sort of 1, 2, 3 system. I can't remember the names of them, but it was like Jazz 1, Jazz 2, and Jazz 3. I sort of made my way through the wind bands and kind of was doing all right by that with that. And then I think, you know, when I was 15 or 16, starting to do the jazz thing. But on the side, I'm not sure how it happened, but I just started playing in a few local soul bands in Northampton.
Oh, okay.
So when I was about 14 or 15, I think, my mum would drive me to these sort of dodgy pubs in Northampton and do these gigs. And so my first, I remember playing like Sweet Soul Music and Try a Little Tenderness and all those kind of brass intros and stuff, and then getting into James Brown and stuff. So, and
were you in a section, or was it just you?
Yeah, it was three of us, and it was, I think it was kind of music school kids basically playing with, you know, the grown-ups effectively. And but it was a really good grounding, because like we were saying about my early sort of memories of music, going from, say, Spandau Ballet to Glenn Miller, where's the gap? What bridges the gap, you know? And so soul music and funk and soul, that's sort of where really my heart is, really, I suppose. And it kind of made sense to me, because it was like kind of pop music but had horns in it.
Yeah, great. Yeah. I was going to ask you about your influences. So I guess it was like you've just answered that question for me. All that kind of soul music and... So what made you decide that you think you could do music as a career? Did you, when did you get the idea that you were going to do, say, music as a job?
Well, there was it's kind of a weird story and maybe not that interesting, but I remember doing work experience. I think when you're 15 and 16, we had you have it 1 week a year or something. And I sort of was into like design and stuff like that. I had an idea, maybe I'd be some kind of graphic designer or an architect even. And I went to work for an architect and for a week, and obviously your work experience kid, you know, you're the guy who just does all the rubbish jobs. And I remember it was raining again and it was cold, and I was standing in like a muddy field. I was in a hole, I think, and I was sort of measuring something to do with the soil or something, and it was just raining, and I was in this kind of overall. I thought, if I'm gonna have a job, I've got to really love what I'm doing, because it's going to take up most of my life. It's going to take up 8 hours of every day practically, because I was coming home and I was so knackered, and I thought, wow, this is my whole life. I've got to make the right choice. So I don't know if I really chose music. It was more that I didn't really want to do anything else.
Was it a process of elimination?
Yeah. But then I was really kind of getting enthusiastic about music. I was just going to mention a sort of a mentor of mine, a guy called John Long, who was a teacher at the Northampton County Music Service, and he really sort of inspired me to sort of listen to music. And I really sort of sought out who I liked, and also taught myself the sort of the harmony and kind of feeling around that kind of thing. So he was a real kind of inspirational person that kind of made me sort of feel like, oh, I do want to do this, you know.
Yeah. So when you were playing in those kind of soul bands, it was all learning it by ear, or just the sections working out, you play this bit and that. So you were really into the kind of technical side of it, or the advanced harmony side of it. It was just fun. You played by ear. It was just, you know, you just kind of had a good enough ear to work that stuff out.
I think maybe there were some parts somewhere, but yeah, it was by ear. And actually, I mean, this is like we said earlier, this is like a therapy session. It's dredging up all these memories. But I remember there was loads of trumpet solos that were in my F sharp minor, and I couldn't play in F sharp minor, so I would just play in G minor and pull the slide out. Which kind of makes it kind of works, but from a physics point of view, doesn't work at all. But I really didn't know what I was doing, and any solos were just either over a blues, which would probably be a blues scale, or just over one chord thing. And so I started to get to know about kind of modes, I suppose, you know, that would work over those kind of things, but definitely just playing by ear really. You know?
Brilliant. So how did you end up being sort of kind of, you know, as technical about playing like you are today, like understanding, did you go to college or did you end up doing anything like that? Any education?
I went to music college. I went to London College of Music, which, you know, it's difficult. I didn't think it was the greatest college really. The good things that I got out of it was meeting Eddie Harvey, who's sadly not around anymore, but he was a really nice guy and was very patient, and we played a lot together. And But prior to that, I did essentially sort of learn myself. I remember just getting like the Abersol books and stuff like that, and there's all like information in there, and I kind of pieced it together.
Right.
And every musician has holes in their knowledge and their technique, I think, and I definitely still have holes and problems and issues and that's why it's a lifetime's work trying to sort of, you know, fill those gaps and, you know, oh, I didn't do that, or I didn't transcribe that, I didn't learn that. So I guess you're still always working on that.
Yeah, and everyone's on their own journey. I think you end up doing things at different times. to, you know, if you need to do have a certain skill for a certain job, then you kind of have to then learn that. And if you don't need that for, you know, for say 5-10 years because you're doing something else, you're kind of doing the things that you can do. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, because if you're doing a pop gig or something, you're not going to be sitting there playing Keith Jarrett tunes, are you? You're going to be learning about what keyboard's best, what sounds good, more that side of things, aren't you? And it's the same with the trumpet, really. You might, you know, I've done lots of different things, and some of it has been sort of high and loud stuff, you know, to put it in one category. And then you're probably not really thinking about jazz that much in that period of your life, you know. So, you know, yeah, you go through these things and revisit things. I always find like going back to doing a salsa gig. If I've not done a salsa gig for a couple of months, it's like, oh well, I really need to get into that music again. There's certain conventions and stuff that you don't think about, but actually you need to be sort of addressing when you're doing it, you know.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, just checking the stream, everything going well, you can all hear. Oh, you've got a mention for Mr. John Long on YouTube. He says, very kind of you, Mr. Gia.
Yeah, so John lives in Kuala Lumpur now and has moved around the world as a teacher, and I think has influenced a lot of people, actually. I mean, I don't want to sort of comment on his teaching style, really, but I think if you can spoon-feed someone information, you can say, well, you've got to play this on a C7 chord, or you've got to do this over this chord progression, but essentially you have to inspire someone to be able to look into it themselves.
You can't
teach someone to play in all 12 keys. That person has to sit there, however boring it is or however hard you find it, you've got to just go through it like mechanically and do it, you know. And like I said earlier on, he's the kind of teacher that kind of lights a fire under you to do that stuff, you know.
Great So inspiring and guy.
Yeah.
So how did you first get into doing sort of sessions and I mean, so you come out of college. What was the first like paid session? Not because obviously you were doing gigs, but say somebody wanted you to come and record for them, for example, record something.
Yeah, that's a tough. Yeah, can't really remember really because, well, you know, I made some notes about stuff. I remember doing quite early on a big session for Maloko, the band Maloko, who did Bring It Back and stuff. And I think I was probably in my early 20s, and that was, you know, at Metropolis Studios, and it was a big deal. And it's like, you've got to go show up on time, and you've got to know what you're doing, all that kind of stuff. So that was an early memory. I guess I would have been doing some recording back in Northampton for a few. I was working with a few singer-songwriters and stuff,
right,
and doing stuff like that, but probably that was for free, and, you know, we were in a band together and all that kind of thing. But paid, I was going to sort of, yeah, probably Maloko is my earliest memory, but I'm pretty sure there was some stuff before that,
right,
I think, as well.
And did you welcome that idea of the session thing and you know, getting paid to turn up and just, you know, getting paid by the hour or the session or something? Is it more lucrative to then doing kind of gigs and things?
Well, there's a few things to that. I mean, I never saw myself as it's a longer answer, but I never saw myself as like a jazz player or a lead trumpet player, and I never professed to be amazing at any of those things. I'm kind of okay, you know, I can do them a bit, you know, but I'm not under any illusion about it. But I think that upbringing playing soul music, which is neither jazz or classical, kind of gave me an appreciation for playing sort of pop stuff and horn section stuff. So I did want to do that kind of thing. It wasn't really about being on a big stage or earning any money or being famous or anything like that. It was about, well, I actually like that music,
yeah,
you know. The thing about sessions I do like is that you can't really hide. You know, you've got to be on your game, and that's tough. You know, you on a jazz gig, things disappear. You know, you play something, you improvise, or you might improvise around a problem in your playing, so you don't actually have to play that note or that harmony.
Very honest of you there.
And also, time is passing and it's forgotten. You know, this in the moment, whereas in a session, obviously, you've got to play it correctly.
So that's a really good discipline then, that you have to kind of
address. And another sort of little thing, which is a little thing, which is used to be a bigger thing, but is, you know, you get paid for your session, and then you'll get PPL, you'll get royalties afterwards. So that's been a nice added bonus. That's maybe another subject, really, how that's sort of structured now. But, you know, yeah, you get paid a bit more. And also, you know, you might get paid the same for a session as you would do for doing a gig abroad. So that's something to think about in the future when maybe you don't want to be touring and stuff like that. Obviously, we've just come out of lockdown, and we'll get into that, I'm sure. But been recording at home a lot, and it's kind of weird to leave the house now and go to work effectively. So the session thing's been good in that respect as well.
Have you seen a change over the years for the amount of sessions you've been offered? the type of music you're playing in the sessions, and also, you know, if you know, is there a lack of sessions? Music's changed, more technologies come into popular music. There's always going to, I guess, there's always going to be the, you know, the vintage sound that people like. Have you seen much changing over the last, you know, decade or so?
Well, I think there's a lot of different changes. Yeah, stylistically, I think, I mean, to use a really kind of bad example, the sort of Mark Ronson, Amy Winehouse era of bringing back sort of Motown horns. I'm generalizing there because they've come, you know, they're different phases. But if you think back to sort of the 80s, there was a lot of kind of LA American style horns on all these pop tracks, you know, all the Kylie stuff, all that kind of stuff. And then maybe there was a bit of a lull and then it came back again. So, you know, that's, you know, and I think, you know, I had to do a session for a guy called John Newman a few years ago.
Okay.
Would you want to keep talking or play?
Oh, let's play. Let's play Stella by Starlight. Stella by Starlight? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
think it said back, and then I didn't get anything, so... So they cut me out, looking at him, so let's carry on. Hopefully. Internet technology. I did a live stream on Sunday and it was fine. So we've done. So this is the 7th or 8th, and then there was one that was really bad. So hopefully. I didn't pray to the internet god this morning. We'll just keep going anyway.
It was me being rude about social media earlier. Maybe it was the. It's karma.
Yeah, there's a little bit back. Okay, cool. Yeah, living in London. When did you move to London and how different is that from living in Northampton? When did you decide to move down?
Well,
unmute. Yeah.
Part of the Northampton County Music thing, we did like a big band competition, and I was really fortunate to win like a little scholarship type thing to the Guildhall summer school. I was probably about 16, so I stayed in London for a week or 2 weeks doing that. So it kind of gave me a taste for it. I can't say that I really enjoyed it, to be honest, but it's got a bit of a shock, you know. But right. But then as I got older, you know, I was 18 and going to music college, I guess you get a bit more, you want to leave home and kind of get on with some other stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, moved to West London when I was 18, and basically, I mean, it's not what you asked, but with the college and stuff like that, everyone else was kind of partying and having a good time, which is what you kind of should do really at college. But yeah. I was kind of going back to Northampton to do some gigs or see my girlfriend at the time. But then the rest of the time, I was just going to jam sessions and going to watch free gigs in London. I got hold of that Jazz in London leaflet. I'm not sure if it's still around anymore, but maybe it's online. But
yeah, it moved online. It's the woman who used to run it moved away and just didn't want to continue it anymore, I think.
Oh, right.
So it kind of moved on. Sarah Chaplin has taken it over, and it's very different now.
Oh, right.
So yeah, the distribution of it being in every jazz club is very different. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember being in a pub like Bull's Head or something or wherever, and just picking up a copy when I left, and I just searched through it, all the free stuff, because as a student I didn't have any money.
That was great for that, because it listed all the really good, all the free stuff, all the jam sessions, all the stuff.
Yeah,
that,
yeah.
Because everyone knows what's happening at 606 and Ronnie's and all that kind of stuff. You can easily go to their website and see stuff like that. But the small gigs that, you know, might be happening around the corner that need some advertising or people need to know where they're on, that used to really tick that box.
Yeah, and I guess if you were a pub owner or, you know, ran a night at a pub, and you can advertise, get people down. So it was a really good resource for people who didn't have any money, you know. And it's, so I used to just go around. I sort of stalked Gerard Pazenza for years, actually, and I had lessons with him as well. But I just used to go around and follow him at all the little pubs that he was playing in with Stan Tracy and people like that. He
Brilliant.
Was always guesting with like trios and quartets, but was playing with Stan quite a lot. And used to just go and watch him, you know, and, you know, because I'd heard the Cantaloupe version, which many people will know, is I think it was on like a KFC advert or something.
That's right, yeah.
It was a Herbie Hancock, obviously original tune with Freddie Hubbard playing.
And it was a kind of like a hip-hop, not hip-hop, but it had that kind of, you know, that kind of drum track in there.
Us three were the band that kind of redid it with Gerard, and that was sort of around and in my...
kind of acid jazz sort of type sound.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So again, you know, that bridging that gap between, you know, the pop music that I was hearing on the radio or whatever, and, you know, classical and jazz, that was kind of in the middle, you know. So, I used to just, I had this crappy old car and used to just drive around and just see him and sort of try and see all the other gigs, you know. And so, yeah, got to know London a bit that way. I didn't really do much sort of student drinking, really, just kind of introduced myself to everyone, went to every jam session, just sort of, and then when it came to leaving college, I actually did have some gigs, which maybe we'll get into, whereas everyone else, not everyone else, but many other people got to like 2 months before the end of the third year and started panicking.
What are they going
to
do next?
Yeah.
Yeah. There's some statistic, and I don't know what it is exactly, but it's something like the amount of music graduates, people that go to a conservatoire or, you know, a dedicated music college, something like 90% of them go on to do like regular jobs.
Oh, really?
And it's only a small amount of people who actually go into the music industry.
I mean, that might also be the market that you're going into, I suppose. You know, people probably see what it's going to be like, and you know, and sort of jump ship before it's too late, you know.
Yeah. But I guess that's
it's interesting that people do that. Yeah, it's interesting to think where all those people are, you know, and the hundreds and thousands of people that go into music colleges in, you know, wherever in UK or around the world every year, where do they all end up? You know, and it's like you say, a small percentage are probably actually doing gigs or making a living out of music.
So when you left college, you had some gigs. What kind of gigs were you doing? Were you doing function gigs? Were you, I remember when I first met you, we used to kind of do a lot of gigs on the Thames, didn't we?
Yeah, well, there was a trumpet player at my college called Simeon Aldred, and he's one of those guys that kind of maybe saw how it was going to go for him. He was a great trumpet player, but I don't think he really wanted to do it. And so he started an events agency and got loads of gigs around town on the boats. Yeah, the boats that go under all the bridges, and you would have to get there at 4 PM and play to a load of drunk people and stuff like that. I mean, nothing's changed really, has it? But it's like that did, you know, help pay to get through college or the other end of it. So I think that's how we met doing that. Also kind of indirectly through Eddie Harvey, who I mentioned, I met a guy called Robin Jones, who's
the percussionist.
Yeah, sadly passed away last year, but he was sort of almost like an Art Blakey kind of figure, that he would take young guys, young musicians, and sort of put them into his two bands. He had a Latin jazz sextet, and then he had King Salsa.
Was it Robin Jones? It was, I can't remember the name.
Well, he had King Salsa, and I think it was a Robin Jones, or maybe Latin Underground or something like
right,
that.
Right, yeah. Because I just remember seeing his name all the time everywhere. Didn't he have an earring, didn't he?
Yeah, and the interesting thing about Robin, he used to play drums and he used to live in New York, and he played with all the kind of main guys. I think he might have played with Chet Baker. I know he played with like Phil Woods and people like that, and in a kind of, I guess, in the 60s and 70s. And then he came over to England and kind of reinvented himself as sort of Latin percussionist of, you know, you don't know where he's from. He had all the chains and the seashells around his neck. And I think he played with a lot of pop bands in the 80s. So he played with Matt Bianco and people like that, and was sort of your pop percussionist that you'd go to back then.
Great.
But then had this, you know, the Latin jazz and the salsa band. And it was quite, I went to his funeral last year, and there were so many musicians there, particularly loads of trumpet players and loads of percussionists.
And there was
so
loads of us sort of
being through his band through various generations, you know, going back, amazing, you know, 20, 30 years, really.
You really need guys like that who work as kind of like mentors almost, and they, you know, like you say, like Art Blakey, and then just bring the talent through all the time.
And it works, you know, you're available and you're hungry to do stuff and you want to learn, so it's kind of a, you know, it's a good reciprocal thing, really. So that was my kind of avenue into the world, into like world music and that kind of stuff, which world music is such a weird term, but, you know, it's for stuff, for music that comes from, you know, like, you know, South America or Caribbean or, you know, Afrobeat and that kind of stuff. That was my avenue into that world.
Yeah, and then you've done quite a lot in that world as well with Kishon Khan.
Yeah, so around the time I met Kishon Khan and Justin Thurger, and we played together for years now.
So Keyshawn's a piano player and Justin's a trombone player.
Yeah, and so they both run a label called Funky Walla, which, check it out. You know, they're recording stuff properly. They're putting stuff out on vinyl. There's almost no sort of commercial angle to it, really. What I mean by that is they're just making the best music they can, and actually people do really like it. And I've been lucky to go on tour with those guys. I went to Bangladesh with those guys, which is a real, from a life, you know, a life perspective, it's like, that's such an interesting thing to do, because we live in our little bubble here, and even though you see stuff on TV and the news, you know, unless you go to somewhere like that, you don't quite know how the rest of the world lives, you know. Yeah. So that was quite a big thing, you know.
So I guess, you know, doing gigs abroad, then starting to play in some of the more established venues in London, I guess.
Yeah.
Maybe the 606 with Robin.
Yeah, my first gig at 606 was with Robin, actually. Yeah, and it was nerve wracking, but great, you know. And now we play there, you know, quite a lot, you know. And it's you know, it's a venue we love, you know. But also, I'll talk about a few things around that time when I met Barnaby. I met Ben Castle as well, and it was the start of kind of reality TV in a way, of the talent show. I mean, obviously there had been talent shows before, but there was a thing called the Pop Idol Big Band. So this is right at the start of Pop Idol, and Ben Castle was and Barney were kind of instrumental in getting me into that. And that was again getting into sort of the pop world, and but it was weird because we were playing in a big band but touring arenas, playing with pop stars like Will Young. So that was another sort of avenue of work that I kind of got into thanks to those guys.
Right. Yeah. So you've obviously played with some amazing, well, really well-known figures in the music industry. What was the thing that you thought, you know, this is, you know, I'm kind of in here now and I'm kind of going to get some more high profile kind of gigs, opposed to, you know, no disrespect to the kind of like people like, you know, Robin Jones, you know, they're great, but it is, you know, it's in the jazz world and it's a small kind of thing compared to going on a world tour, for example. How did you make that step, or what was the first gig that you know, was it the Will Young thing that opened doors for you for that?
Well, I think you're right. I think you put it in a good way, and it isn't any disrespect, because actually the best music is played at sort of a grassroots level. You know, like you say, you can't hide in those scenarios, whereas possibly in some more pop or commercial scenarios you can hide. The Pop Idol thing was a good thing, because I didn't do NYJO or anything, you know, National Youth Jazz Orchestra. I sort of bypassed all that and met everyone at the other end, if you like, Pop Idol. So it was like Chris Dagley and those kind of people. But I also started doing James Taylor Quartet. So there's a promoter in Northampton called Andy Shaw, and I'd sort of played with him when I was, or for him in his venues when I was a kid, basically. And he knew that James needed a trumpet player. This is a long time ago. And so I went and played with James for sort of 4 or 5 years, touring around Europe and things like that. And again, that was sort of, although it wasn't pop and it wasn't jazz, it was in the middle, and it kind of maybe sort of placed me as a sort of a pop horn section sort of trumpet player. So that was good. One of the good things that came out of that, you know.
Yeah, and so there's great players played in his band. Because I think, I didn't realise this till recently, that Nigel Price played in James Taylor Quartet.
Yeah, I mean, I won't get into it too much, but a lot of people have been through it for good and bad reasons, you know. But lots of people have done it. Nigel's done it, and lots of great horn players. I actually did it with the original lineup, who did it for nearly 20 years. So, and they're all amazing musicians and great funk and soul players, you know. And so I really learned a lot from those guys.
Right.
It was a good kind of training ground. And also the touring thing as well, which, you know, get driving in a transit van around Italy, you know, it was hard, but it was kind of a good...
Really eye-opening.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. So, your world tour, that must take us to how you were kind of invited, or how did you get the kind of bin in the horn section to do the Kylie Minogue world tour? How did that come about?
Well, with Kylie, yeah. I was doing pop stuff. I mean, I'm friends with a guy called Bob Knight who started to book a lot of pop gigs and TV things, and when they want a band on Strictly Come Dancing or, you know, any kind of pop music program, you know, even like Top of the Pops back then, that kind of thing. Bob was booking those things, and he was very kind and got me in a lot of those things. I'm not entirely sure of the chronology of it, but I did Mel, Simi and Barney to do that. And through that, we met Sarah, the MD of Mel C. She then became the musical director for Kylie. There's time in between this, but so got asked to go and do that. And it was like, well, this is kind of crazy, really, because I've not massively been a fan of Kylie, but then there's all this work and this, you know, this huge opportunity here. So
yeah. Did you ever have to think about, because if I'm right, you asked, I think you told me this, that it was going to be one length of time, and then they added some more length of time onto the end of it.
Yeah.
So did you have to think about it and say, well, this is a massive chunk of my life, or was it a no-brainer, it's loads of money, you know, it's regular income, it's the chance to see the world? There must be pros and cons of doing that kind of thing.
There's definitely pros and cons, yeah. And it wasn't really quite like that. I mean, I think every sort of, let's call it a promotional campaign, you know, if someone brings out an album, they will do a certain amount of promotion, and then they'll see how it goes, I suppose. So I think that was the thing with Kylie, that it was a new band, a totally new band, and new experiment to have horns in the band, and so we did whatever, a 3-month stint of, say, Europe, and then we go home for a bit, you know, and it wasn't continuous, so
okay,
there might be a few months in between,
right.
But then the call would come in, oh, we're going to go and do Asia, or we're going to go to Australia now, or and then we're going to go and do America, but they'd be in chunks, and I think the longest chunk was a 3-month sort of sleeper bus tour around Europe, so it wasn't anything like, oh, you've got to commit to 2 years of touring, even though it kind of was that. I could fit in other work in between it,
right,
which was great, you know, and it's all kind of slotted in. I suppose, you know, some of the other gigs that we're doing fell by the wayside because you just can't do them, but I tried to be honest with those people and they all understood how it was going, so, and there is money involved and status, and, you know, you asked me a question earlier and I was thinking, well, there is a certain amount of ego involved in that, you know, you want to get to be the, you know, the best.
But yeah, you want to be the person they go to because you can do the job and everyone sees you there as that's the guy to book.
Yeah, and ironically, yeah, on the Kylie tour in particular, I wasn't going to mention this, but I'm going to say it, I think my playing was probably the worst it's ever been because you're not practicing as much as you should do. Your focus is elsewhere. You know, you're traveling, you're tired, all the rest of it. And you're not going, you know, normally when you're freelancing, living in London, for example, you're doing a different gig, you know, a couple of times a week or, you know, however busy you are, and you're challenged every time, where if you're just playing the same music all the time, and there was also brass on track, you know, a lot of these pop gigs there's stuff on track, so you were kind of buried in things, so
yeah. You must have done a lot of miming gigs over the years too.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, you know, yeah. And when I've, interestingly, when I've put stuff on social media over the years, you definitely get more attention and likes from a miming high profile gig than you do from a non-miming low profile gig. I remember there was two gigs in 1 week, and it was CeeLo Green on Jonathan Ross, and I did like my own band at 606 or somewhere, and you know, you get a million likes on the CeeLo Green post and no likes and no audience at the jazz gig. But I'm exaggerating a bit, but you know, people like celebrity, don't they? So that I kind of, yeah, understand it.
I think we're still rolling. Hope so. Let us know if we're not. There's not much we can do, but it looks like I can see movement on us anyway. So, yeah. So when you kind of finish the tour like that, are you thinking I need to do something completely different, or is it just waiting for the phone to ring, or is it just opportunist to do, say, the next thing, like when you started working, say, with Kyle Eastwood, for example? Was that around about the same time, or before or after?
Well, I met Kyle, no, prior to that, actually. I was 25 when I met Kyle, and I just got a random call to go down to the 606 for a kind of an audition, really. I mean, I was the only trumpet player there, and I think it was me and Dave O'Higgins on saxophone, and I think maybe Jeremy Stacey on drums, and Andrew McCormack on piano, and got the gig, and started to tour and gig with Kyle for pretty much 10 years, actually, probably eight or 9 years. But
is that because he moved to London and he was looking for a
He moved. He moved, right, to London, yeah, moved to Chelsea, and then even after that, he moved to Paris. So he's always kind of local-ish, you know.
Yeah.
We essentially kind of did a world tour with him, but spread out over 10 years, you know.
Right, yeah.
And it would be like a week at a time and then maybe a month off. So with the Kylie and the Kyle tours, I was basically coming off tour with Kylie and then going straight on tour with Kyle. And so it was pretty intense really, because it wasn't just playing in Guildford and playing in Cambridge. It was like, I mean, I sound like I'm showing off, but I'm highlighting how actually it was quite hard. You know,
you were living pretty much on a plane during that time.
Yeah, you come off a gig in New York with Kylie and then have to fly, come home for a few days and then fly to Japan to do the Blue Note with Kyle,
and those are completely different pressures and problems and flying and your health and all that kind of stuff. It throws up loads of other kind of issues. I mean, the, you know, I'm guessing Kylie and Kyle Eastwood gigs pay okay and quite well, but then you've got to, there's the stuff that comes with that as well, as being on the road and just, you know, jumping on off planes all the time.
Yeah, I think a thing that I think is I like to try and talk about, if I can, to people, younger musicians, which makes me sound like an old guy, but it's just looking after your, well, primarily, yeah, your mental health and your physical health. And I think the sleep deprivation is one of the main things. And if you want to play internationally, you've got to get on a plane. You know, that's an obvious thing to say, but most of the time these flights that people book you on are, you know, 7 a.m. And I remember some of the early touring with various bands and stuff, and you'd finish a, you know, a Friday night gig at 1 a.m. in the morning, and almost and drive straight to the airport, you know, because you've got to be, you've got to get to Stansted for 5 a.m. or something. And that's fine, you know, when you're younger and you know you want to do that kind of stuff, but I think over time it can be quite bad for you, you know. And the coping mechanisms for that is usually alcohol, caffeine, and then eating bad food, not exercising, all that kind of stuff. And I think when you're in your 20s, you can bounce back from it, but I think it's just something to be wary of. And you see it with young guys, they get into some band and they're locked into it, that's their only gig they have, and they have to go, they have to do it, they have to get on that flight, otherwise they're not going to get paid. And it's, I guess it's a double-edged sword. You're doing a great gig, but you know, it, maybe it's not always good for your health.
No, yeah. Have you always had job security, as it were? Have you, we're all freelancers. Have you ever worried when the next gig or the next tour or anything like that is ever coming in at all? Have you always been kind of very comfortable in yourself, thinking, right, the phone's always going to ring or somebody's going to text or whatever? Have you ever had any of that anxiety at all?
Well, yeah, but I think over years you kind of bury it down a bit, really. I mean, and it sits there as a low level anxiety, but you know, just I won't go into it too much, but you know, I don't, you know, it's not like I have a rich family or, you know, a family house out in the countryside that I can retreat to. You know, it's all on me. I'm married now, and we work as a partnership, you know, in that sense, you know. And there's a, you know, someone you can lean on, and my wife Annabelle is very supportive.
I think she was on here earlier.
She got bored. you know, so you can work as a partnership like that. But there was a lot of kind of low level underlying pressure on, like, well, because now we're just coming sort of effectively out of lockdown from the coronavirus. I mean, we're still not really sure what's going on. And,
no.
You know, that really highlights to me and a lot of people how precarious things are. And also, but, you know, it shows that you need to have a lot of things going on, playing with a lot of different people.
Just your eggs in one basket, as it were.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So you just wanted to touch on mental health, because I know you did, you know, before we started today, said you wanted to talk about that a little bit. Mm. Have you had any kind of issues where you've had to take time out of playing, or had to, you know, maybe look after yourself physically more, or any kind of things like that that have kind of, any, you know, had problems over the years at all?
Yeah, and I think it's important to talk about it. I mean, obviously, it's people don't want to sort of go on about their problems, and I'm definitely not going to do that. But I did have some quite bad problems, and I think it's important to be open about it, because everyone has problems, and the more people aren't aware of it, and more people don't talk about it, then it makes their problems worse, you know. And I think it's important to show that you can have problems and get through them. You know, we all have problems in life, and I think life is never sort of straightforward. I'm not going to wallow in it, but I did have some problems particularly after the Kylie tour. I started playing with a singer called Rumour, and I was also playing with John Newman at the time. And for some reason, I don't know, the anxiety and the panic attacks and that kind of stuff crept up on me to the point where, you know, it was really difficult for me to even leave the house at some points, which is, you know, a sad thing to hear, a sad thing to say, but that's the way it was. But and so I had to take time out from gigs. You know, I was so worried about it. You know, your reputation's in tatters. You know, oh, no one's going to book me again, all that sort of stuff. But you know, like I say, look, you get challenges in life, and you have to sort of move through them. You know,
and I guess they're your own demons. You have to. And how did you? What was your coping mechanism? Did you seek help? Did you? Is it something you battled for yourself? Did you? How did you? How did you kind of approach getting
better? Yeah, I did seek help. I did absolutely everything I could. You know, I'm sort of a bit of an expert on it, really. You know, right. I'm qualified, but expert. Yeah, there were some points I was going to say. I think the health thing is really important, you know, to get through that kind of stuff. And recently, I don't think it's necessarily going down to the gym and lifting a lot of weights. I think you need to look at, especially if you're playing an instrument, there's so much tension in your body. And I think you can hold on to that tension in whatever way you want to think about that, in a sort of Western medicine way or an Eastern medicine way. So I think if you're a musician, you should be looking into things like yoga, Alexander technique, looking at your posture, all that kind of stuff. I haven't got it sorted, but those things definitely helped me let go of a lot of stuff, you know, in whatever way you want to think about that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I think, I was going to say to you, I don't want to make it weird for you, but one of key things for me in that period, I was really struggling, but you offered me a quartet gig at the Hampton Festival that you were running. And I thought, I want to do this, but it's going to be tough for me to go out, stand in the middle of, in front of a band, in front of an audience, run the band, talk to the audience, you know, coming from what I'd just been through. And actually, it was the best thing I could have done, because it actually felt entirely comfortable doing it. And it was a real therapy moment. So thank you for that.
Oh, no, it's a pleasure. I can remember that. It was great. It was a great, great gig. And there's a difference, isn't there, between being in the horn section, even if you're playing to, say, 30,000 people or something, and being, you know, just there's a security of playing with others and being in the background to a certain extent. But when you have to front something, I mean, this is quite a thing in itself as well, having to talk directly to people. You're the face, you're the person, all the eyes are on you, sort of thing. And people have paid money to come and see you, so you must be, you know, you better be good, sort of thing. Do you know? There's those sort of pressures as well, aren't there?
Yeah, because you're a TV presenter as well, aren't you? You're suddenly gone from being a musician who's practicing in his bedroom or whatever, you know, just a guy at the back of the stage.
Yeah.
To, I've got to be at the front and I've got to introduce this tune and tell a funny story. Or, you know what I mean? Your skill set kind of gets larger. But I think, just to sort of go back on the pop stuff, although it's amazing, it can leave you sort of like a child almost, because you've got no sense of responsibility, because someone's, you know, you've got food provided for you and it, someone's telling you where to go. You've got no stability at home. You know, you're renting a room in a flat or something. You've got a suitcase at home. You've got all that kind of stuff. You're probably not in a relationship and all that kind of stuff. And I think that lack of independence is not good for you growing up, you know. And I think that's another key thing, is like, just have a life outside of music, because then it gives you a bit of perspective. Music is important, but it's not the be all and end all. And I think that's a good thing for your own personal confidence. Because stage fright, I think, is not always about being frightened of playing music. It's just an anxiety thing that manifests itself on stage.
Yeah. Yeah, good point. Great. Should we do something else? Should we do another tune?
Yeah.
Should we do that? Pat Metheny one?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I remember getting that album actually on cassette, the Secret Story, Pat Metheny album.
Matt Powell says, love your style of playing, finding your chat really interesting. At the point myself where I'm deciding whether to pursue going to study trumpet or not. What would you say to that?
Well, thanks for the compliments. I appreciate that. I guess I assume maybe he's thinking about going to college, I suppose. Is that maybe what we're... It's difficult to say, but...
I guess it's a, you know, it's a different answer to for everybody, isn't it? I guess you can't. Yeah. It's not one thing.
I mean, I'm not sure of the costs involved in going to music college now, and I don't want to say don't go to music college. I just wonder if sometimes that money, say it's $9,000, I think it's maybe $9,000 a year or something, whatever it is, if you're structured with it and you're disciplined, maybe you could use that money in better ways to get lots of different lessons with different people, lots of harmony lessons with different people, you know, lessons in how to use logic, all that kind of stuff. I mean, I'm not saying you can't get that at music college, but you might want to just weigh up the pros and cons of, is it worth it, you know? And if you're living at home, is it worth sort of spending the money on rent and that kind of stuff, where you could put that money into something else or even record your own stuff, you know, later on, you know?
Yeah.
I guess the structure of college means that you will actually do it, whereas, you know, have you got the self-discipline to put that money into the right areas when you're 18, you know?
Yeah, I mean, unless you're going into teaching an establishment, I guess, there's no guarantee that, you know, the kind of gigging and touring and all that kind of stuff, you're going to be any worse or better off, you know, so...
Yeah, definitely, when college...
And everyone's got a degree these days, haven't they, or something. So it's not like a... It's, you know, everybody goes to college for everything now, don't they?
Yeah, and a music degree, although I think it's, you should try and get one if you can, I suppose. It's never helped me, you know, with any work. But who knows, like we're saying, who knows when it might all end and I might need a degree to do something else.
Yeah, sure.
One thing I was going to say, when I auditioned for college, I auditioned for all the colleges and I didn't get into Guildhall, I didn't get into the Academy. I got offered places out of London, but I thought it would be better to be in London for the work aspect, because I know people that studied in Leeds and did amazingly and are great players, but probably had to start again when they moved to London, you know, and sort of make all these contacts that maybe you would already make if you were at the college in town.
I guess it's a networking thing, isn't it? You know, as much as anything, you did the right thing by kind of to going around and doing all the going to all the jam sessions and meeting all the right people and socializing with them.
And it doesn't have to be in any kind of contrived or weird way. It's just you want to get to know people, don't you?
And
networking is a sort of funny word, isn't it? But I guess you've got to put yourself out there. You know?
Yeah, there's good ways and bad ways of doing it, I suppose. If you're just seen as that guy who just goes around networking, it's got a kind of completely different kind of sound and feel about it, hasn't it?
And it's sort of an obvious thing. If you can play, you know, if you practice and you're an easy guy to get on with and you're
it's just being well known, isn't it? It's people knowing you, and you know, and I don't think there's anybody I would say that I've come into contact with who, you know, if they play the trumpet or do any sort of kind of jazz or pop thing that probably doesn't know you or know of you. So, which is a good thing.
So
I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? It's so your reputation precedes you, as it were. So, but like I say, you've worked, you know, the last couple of decades working on that, haven't you? So
and I think I've always tried to put 100% into every gig that I've done, which is hard, and it's kind of mentally challenging, you know, to keep up that intensity, you know.
Having worked with you over the years, I can definitely say that it doesn't matter what the job is, I can honestly say that you've approached it with the same vigor and wanting to play well, if it's somebody's wedding or, you know, like the TW12 or something like that, you're still, or even playing in Southampton to like a small pub or something, you still want to represent yourself and play well and have a good time and, you know, and give the punters and the band, you know, the other people in the band a good time as well. Do you know? So it's,
thank you. Yeah. Well, because we're not in it for the money, are we? We're in it, you know, even going back to the pop thing, you know, even if you do earn some money in 3 months, you'll probably have 3 months off, so everything levels out. So essentially you've got to be doing it for the love. And even a gig, you know, out of town, like Southampton's a good example. Ted Carrasco, the a drummer down there and venue runner. He's such a great player and such a great guy, and you always want to go down there and play well for him. So I'll always get charts together, try some different stuff, try some different arrangements. Let's just do something different and get something out of this gig for all of us, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
Otherwise, you're just going to go down there and play the same old stuff, and what's the point, you know?
No, exactly. So I've got lots of questions here. We're talking about health and everything. So we've done a couple of half. We did a half marathon together, didn't we?
Yeah.
Which was supposed to be in Richmond on a lovely flat course, and it was your first one. And I thought, yeah, I'll get you into doing this. And unfortunately, the weather was so bad; it was snowing, and it was snowed off. So we thought, well, we've got this level of fitness, let's carry on and do another one. And we ended up doing the Wimbledon one, which was like the hilliest course you've ever seen. And it was just raining, and it was just like running through mud.
It was just a bog, wasn't it, all the way to it?
So has that put you off doing anything like that again? Or are you still up for, are you still into health and exercise and all that kind of stuff now?
Well, I don't want to commit to any half marathons just right now, but... I think my view at the moment, and I'm very changeable with this kind of stuff, as my wife will agree, at the moment I'm sort of thinking about things in a more holistic way, and all these words can be sort of interpreted in different ways. I think there's sort of, I always think it's like Western medicine and there's Eastern medicine, and there's some kind of area in the middle of those things. So at the moment I'm thinking more about kind of posture, Alexander technique, yoga, breathing techniques, that kind of stuff. I think, you know, running and stuff is great, but maybe when you are getting a bit older, maybe it's not great for your knees, so you have to be thinking about that sort of stuff. I'm into more sort of full body approaches to that kind of stuff, and ways of combating the problems that you get from playing instruments over many years, you know. And trumpet players have a lot of tension in their necks and shoulders, and you shouldn't be playing with loads of pressure. You know, the idea is that the pressure of the mouthpiece only creates a seal against the skin of your face, right? So the air didn't escape. However, probably hardly any trumpet players play it with no pressure at all, right? Probably most trumpet players play with too much pressure, so you're in this position for years and years, pushing the trumpet into your face to play higher, and that, you know, causes problems in your jaw, causes problems in your neck, in your shoulders, in your arms, you know. And it can be bad for a lot of players. You know, some players will split the muscle going around their mouth and they'll never play again, all that kind of stuff. So you need to, I think people, trumpet players, try and learn to play a bit more efficiently as they get older and make it easier for themselves.
Yeah, that's one of the things. Do trumpet players lose their chops as they get older? Is there a, you know, is there a cutoff point? Do you have to be, you know, and is there enough, like some of the things you're talking about there, are there books, are there people you can go to say, you know, my posture's not right, you know, is there an opportunity for you to write there, how to play the trumpet properly or something?
Well, like I said, I'm a very unqualified, partial expert on a lot of different things, so I'm probably not the best person. But I mean, looking into the marathon running, you know, I looked into a lot of, I read some books on barefoot running and all that kind of stuff, and actually ultra running and that kind of stuff is something you get better at as you get older. There's quite a lot of men and women in their 40s and 50s doing really well at that kind of stuff. So it depends on how you view your instrument, really. I guess when you get into 65-70, possibly your muscles are going to get too weak to play, and it's a natural aging process, isn't it? Yeah, your muscles lose tone, and apparently you lose collagen in your face. I don't know too much about that, but I think that's why you just have to be a bit smarter about it, really. And I definitely need to sort of practice what I preach, but you know, going and doing a Saturday night wedding band on a function gig and smashing the trumpet into your face all night is not going to be good for you long term. So you have to take rests, take breaks, find an easier way of doing that. Maybe take the next day off, don't practice that day, you know, if you're really bruised. So yeah, I think you just need to be a bit smarter about it, and hopefully one will have a longer career going into old age, you know.
Great. And talking about the actual trumpet you're playing, what are your favorite instruments, and is what are your considerations on choosing an instrument and playing a particular instrument?
Well, I could talk for days about this, and trumpet player friends of mine will know. So many trumpet players are geeks about this sort of stuff. And there's a reason for that, because the connection with this bit of metal to your face defines everything in your life in a way, because it defines how you work, how much you're going to earn, everything. So this rim of metal is really important. And if you're doing lots of different kinds of work, then that's hard, because I think the demands on professional trumpet players are greater now, because you have to be able to play high, and you have to be able to improvise, and you have to be able to play, you know, salsa stuff. We might have to play classical music. Whereas, I'm not saying you didn't have that before, but there were certain players that would be specific to those styles. So, in terms of like commercial music and wanting to be able to nail it every time, I think Yamaha is a really good manufacturer of trumpets, because you know that if you've had a hard gig the night before and then you've got a 10 o'clock session the next day, the trumpet is going to work. Whereas if you've got some vintage trumpet, like a, say you're into Miles Davis and you want to get a Martin trumpet from the 50s, but it has that sound, brilliant, that's great, but you don't want it to fall apart on you the next morning. You know, you've got enough to worry about, so it's got to work. However, I do like Bach trumpets, and I sort of feel like they sound kind of the best, really. They resonate in the right way. There's lots of really new custom manufacturers that have all the good elements of those two things, so you have to sort of try, but I think Yamaha and Bach work for me.
And do you think a lot of the sound is actually just the player, the musician as well? You'll sound the same on whatever instrument you're playing to a certain degree?
I think so. People say that, but like it's some magical, mystical thing. But yeah, of course, you know, my teeth are different to your teeth, and my lips are different to yours, and the way I hold myself and is different. So if you picked up the trumpet, you'd sound different. And that's why there's some people that are naturally great at playing crazy high, or people that naturally have a big sound for classical music. But you can change that with practice, and you can change that with mouthpieces and bore sizes and weights of metal and all that kind of stuff. So there are ways around that kind of stuff. And also playing flugel, playing cornet, you know, for whatever you want to do, there's options with that kind of stuff.
Great. I think maybe we'll just play another song, and then if anybody any more questions on here, and then we'll come back and talk about some of your projects and future projects and all that kind of stuff, maybe.
Yeah, great.
Cool. What should we play?
Thank you.
Right, okay, so where do we get to? Okay, should we talk about what you're going to be up to, any projects that are coming up? You've got a new group that you've just signed to a record label, or a new project or something?
Yeah, well, just to backtrack slightly, sorry to...
go ahead.
One of the main things I found helped with the problems I had before with sort of anxiety was actually getting some projects together, getting involved with people that was sort of my own, you know, that I was a trumpet player or was my thing, however small. And I think it's really important to do that. So you're not just getting dragged along by some other kind of machine. It's like you've got your little duo or whatever recording you've done. I think it's so important to have your baby effectively. So that was one of the things I really tried to do out of that period. I just wanted to say that because I thought it was an important
point. Yeah, definitely.
Point. So I've always tried to sort of, recent years I've tried to get a lot of projects going, or at least be enthusiastic about other projects that I've been involved with and try and help as much as I can. Even if I'm not contributing with compositions or writing, you know, I want to try and help those people as much as I can, even if it's just being enthusiastic. Can I just sort of like a shout out list?
Yeah,
I don't want to go through everything, but just...
No, definitely.
With Keyshawn Khan and Justin, we've been working with an Afrobeat singer and piano player called Dele Sosimi. He played with Fela Kuti, I think, back in the 80s. So he's kind of Afrobeat royalty. And we've been recording and working together for years. So we've got some gigs coming up. Jazz Cafe on the 19th of September, if you can make that. And also the 30th of September. It's not quite the same, but it's similar. A reincarnation of that kind of group as well. So, and we're fusing like Afrobeat and salsa and some hip hop and some funk.
Will that be a concert or a live stream or just a concert?
That's actually a concert. Right. So the Jazz Cafe is opened right now. I think there's, you know, there's social distancing and all that kind of stuff. But
it's big enough, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's an actual gig in front of real people. So it's, we're looking forward to that. I think there's two shows that evening, so early show, late show. So check that out and check out Funky Walla Records, because Keyshawn is doing great work with that, and lots of interesting stuff coming out of that record label. Yeah,
he's such a lovely guy as well. I've only really met him and chatted to him a few times.
Keyshawn,
and he's such a, he seems like a really nice guy, and he's got time and he's interested in what everyone's doing and other people's projects and stuff, which is great.
Well, he's doing it for the right reasons, you know. He's doing it for the music, and he's, you know, he's not overly political, but he has a really good view of what's going on in the world. And he's, I really respect that guy. He's just doing the right thing.
Got a good moral compass.
Yeah. And he's not trying to make money, but he's trying to create work for people, for the community around him. So he's it's kind of an old school approach, but it's the right approach, I think, you know. I don't want to go through it like loads of too much stuff. Gabriele Probetti is a sax player. He plays with Stormzy at the moment, but or was before lockdown. And I've worked with him quite a lot in various groups. And he's got an EP coming out. And the first single is out on the 2nd of October. So check him out. Find him on social media and all that kind of stuff. Also, through Gabriele, I think, I met a guy called Greg Sanders. And he's just... written an EP, an album or EP with a singer called Juanita Ayuka, and I've been playing on that, so that's out soon. It's kind of weird going through all this list. Is it too many? It's too many things.
No, it's good to get them out.
I'm always playing with Clement Rijert, his band called Wildcard. He's a very prolific arranger and is always getting new tunes together, and we're always playing around town, so check him out, his social media.
Well, I did some lockdown videos, and Clement played on one of my... I did like a kind of arrangement of Fragile by Sting.
Oh yeah.
And Clement played, I got him to come and play some guitar on that.
Yeah, it's great just gigging in all the venues around London. He's very proactive, and again, sort of, he's very good at the kind of getting the gigs and stuff like that, but he is doing it for the right reason, you know, because he wants to play. Tim Rose is a great guitarist who I met actually doing a touring theatre show, actually. But, you know, he writes some great tunes. He's got an album out called Fact and Opinion. So check that out.
He actually lives in my hometown. He used to live in Sydney. That's where I grew up.
Of course, yeah. I keep forgetting.
But we never met each other. I think he moved after I kind of was long gone, basically.
Yeah, he went to the Guild. He does. I mean, he's a great writer and a great improviser. He also does a lot of West End shows and that kind of stuff, I think. So different worlds, you know. Another project I'm involved with, which is sort of based down in Hastings, is a band called Hexagonal. And that's with Jason Yard, Greg Heath, John Donaldson, Simon Thorpe and Tristan Banks. And we do the music of Becky M. Seleku, who is a South African pianist who's sadly not with us, but lived in London for a while. And we're kind of doing some music of his and also McCoy Tyner. So we've done a kind of a lockdown recording, so there'll be some stuff coming out from that. So check them out. I don't want to miss anyone out, but I know I can't just list everything. I'm always working with a guy called Michele Chiviarini. He's one of the sort of kind of behind the scenes, has defined a lot of the house and funky house sort of scenes in the UK. You know, he's a great multi-instrumentalist and a great writer and a great producer. So I've always worked with him, and we're always doing stuff. And he's just started a new record label called Spry Records. So I'll check them out. You know, lots of interesting sort of jazz-influenced melodies and harmony over house grooves and that kind of stuff. I mean, that kind of condenses it to less than it is, but it's check out Spry Records. I apologize if I've missed out people that I'm working with. It's just a time, really, but I just really wanted to mention this new project that we did during lockdown with an old friend of mine, Chris Bestwick, who actually played with James Taylor Quartet. This is a long time ago. He now lives in Helsinki in Finland, and we started playing around, doing some throwing some ideas around, and we made an EP mainly of Chris's compositions, and we approached some labels, and we've just signed a deal with Ropadope Records, or Ropadope as they like to be branded, which is an American label that Christian Scott is on, I think Snarky Puppy were possibly on them before, but Christian Scott is one of their main musicians on the label, and we just signed a deal with them, so that'll be an EP out in December, I think, the 11th, and the project is called Archie the Goldfish. And it's a fusion of it's kind of a chill out kind of EP with jazz influences. So we're excited about that. You know, it's good to have the confidence of a record label behind you.
Brilliant.
And
thanks for clearing up who Archie the Goldfish was, because they liked one of my Instagram posts or Facebook posts. And I thought, so now I know who that is.
Well, enter the murky world of Instagram and all that kind of stuff with that project. The release is in December. There's going to be a pre-release of a single in November. So I guess there will be a bit of social media stuff up to that point, but Chris and I are both excited about that. So
right.
And Lewis Marks, who runs the company and the label, is quite a socially conscious, interesting guy. You know, again, not particularly in it for the money, but he's pushing new acts. So we're excited to work with Lewis.
Brilliant. Alec Tuff asks, any gigs planned for the new year?
Alec. Hi, Alec. For the new year, it's so tough to say, obviously, at the moment, because venues are opening up slowly. Terry and I discussed earlier that you're never totally confident there's not going to be another lockdown and a second wave of the virus and all that kind of stuff. So it's very difficult to say. I think there'll be lots of gigs, hopefully, with all these projects and other on the sort of more jazz side of things. I think there'll be lots of things happening. And also I play in various places around London that are more private events and stuff like that. Hopefully that will all kick off. I don't really know about how on a more international scene, how that will work. You know, I know that big promoters and stuff are probably going to be reluctant to book a tour in for who knows how long. So yes, I personally have sort of little gigs coming in for next year, which I'll put on my social media, but if I'm totally honest, I don't have any chunk of work, and I don't really know anyone that does have any chunks of work that are really coming in. I do this thing with the Heritage Orchestra, the Ibiza Classics. I've played on the albums and I've done the tours with Jules Buckley conducting and Pete Tong. I think there may be some stuff next year with that that's been rescheduled, but at the moment it's all up in the air. So me and my wife will just come and visit you, Alec. Alec lives in Canada. He's my brother-in-law. So.
Oh, there you go. My sister lives in Canada and she's on here too. She lives in Montreal.
All right.
So we'll just go, do a little tour yeah. together. Yeah. Brilliant. So I think we'll just do one more tune and then any more questions you guys have got, we'll wrap that up at the end. We're doing a gig actually next month here, aren't we?
Yeah, is it October the 11th?
October the 11th.
Yeah.
In this very room, we're going to be playing some Chet Baker material, I guess, like a tribute to Chet Baker. This gig's been moved about four times, hasn't it? It was initially supposed to be at a different venue in central London, on the South Bank, but obviously because of the coronavirus thing, we've had to move that to... we changed the date for another date there, and then we've had to move it to here. And then we moved it from the Thursday to a Sunday. So it's definitely going ahead, 100%. And it's now going to be a quartet rather than a trio gig. The venue in Waterloo is quite a small, intimate type place. Lovely classical music, kind of like a chamber, you know, they do lots of chamber music and that kind of stuff there. So as we're playing in a bigger room, we've decided to do it as a quartet with Sophie Alloway on drums and Richard Sadler on bass, who was originally booked for the other original date. So maybe we'll do something from that now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'll work on the ending for the gig.
Well, I think on that gig maybe we'll do Chet, you know, Chet Baker tunes, but also I always think those things are good to kind of develop on what they've done a bit, and it's not just about how he did them, but maybe how would he be playing them now, you know, if he was around, you know.
Yeah. And he's another interesting one as well, because he's had, you know, his career with his getting his teeth knocked out or whatever happened to him. He's also had to change his sound and his approach over the years as well, hasn't he?
Yeah, just such a, you know, amazing player. And actually, if you check him out, because I'm in sort of popular culture, when you see him playing and the more recent stuff, you know, it's all about the heroin addiction and how fragile he is. But if you go back to him playing when he was young, he's got an outrageous sound then, you know, and great technique, and just is an amazing trumpet player. But then unfortunately, the things that happened to him, although they're unfortunate, they also gave him a different sound, you know, a really fragile sound. So, but then, you know, obviously a victim of his own demons, you know, unfortunately.
Yeah, great. Let's check out some questions. Public admitted, it will be both, Derek. People will be in the building, socially distanced, so all COVID safe here, and also we'll be streaming it online. So, keep an eye on Mood Indigo Events, or Graeme will probably let you know. And
hi, Derek.
You can be able to watch it online, and we probably will. We've done 7 live streams, and each time we do a different one, we have a new bit of equipment. So we've got a new mixer, and hopefully for the next one, we'll have 2 cameras on the go, so rather than just one. So they're just getting better, higher quality each time. So it's going to be in this building, in this room. I'm looking forward to that. Should be good fun.
Good.
Any other questions? Booking ahead. So future ambitions. Obviously, you talked about your projects that you're kind of going to be doing in the near future. How do you see the next, you know, if, you know, again, this is COVID dependent. How do you see the next chapter of your life? You know, anything, things you really want to do musically, give up playing, you know, become a farmer or something. Any ambitions, anything that you know, boxes you need to tick off, more of the same? How do you see things going?
It's a good question, isn't it? Because, yeah, things are, it depends how things open up or if they don't open up, you know. I feel like the start of your career is, or for me, can be a lot about your career and the music industry, and like you're getting to a certain position within the industry, ego things and stuff like that, and then probably a bit of music, interesting music. I'm generalizing really, but you know, and I feel as you maybe get a bit older, you see the industry for what it is and are possibly not quite as sort of starstruck by things. And music, and wanting to be a better musician, takes over. So trumpet's such a hard instrument. One of my ambitions is just to keep sort of playing at a basic standard and trying to get better. I'm constantly trying to sort of deconstruct things. And I think for me, being distracted by other things, like stuff to do with types of trumpet and mouthpieces and then social media and all that kind of stuff, I'd really like to try and pare that away a bit more, just to sort of get down to doing some proper practice. I know that's a weird thing to say, but I think we're just so easily distracted by things.
That's the thing with musical instruments as well. It's like filling the bath with the plug out, isn't it? It's one of those things you've got to be on top of it all the time. You can't leave it alone and just to play a musical instrument, you've got to practice. You keep your chops up, keep mentally as well as physically, because. You know, you might be physically be able to play something, but it's also being inside the music as well, isn't it? Being able to think fast, being able to play what you hear in your head, all these things you have to practice as well as actually playing the instrument itself.
Yeah, and there's so many aspects to it. And I found it difficult seeing older musicians who kind of were sitting on their high horses because they'd played with a certain person 20 years ago, but actually weren't that good in front of me, and I don't want to ever be that guy, you know.
Yeah,
only as good as your last gig, or how the last time, you know, what can I learn from what I've just played, you know. I think the main thing as a musician is to be honest with yourself, whether you choose to lie to the audience or anyone else, is that's another thing, but you've got to be honest with yourself and think, what can I learn from how I play today? How could I do it differently? What do I need to work on? So those are the sort of things I need to work on. Career-wise, it is really difficult to say. Just try and make better music, really. And if that brings some commercial success, then that's great. But I'm sort of confident that if you're playing as well as you can and you're playing good music and are honest and harsh with yourself about stuff and the people around you, then you can make great music and make great art. I know that sounds a bit pretentious, but it is an art form and we want to make good albums and make good music. So that's probably all I could say at the moment, really.
Yeah, because it's good to also have some sort of legacy or something that you can leave behind, because you can make a load of money over, say, 20 years or something, but if you've got nothing of note that you've done or achieved or played on or experiences, then you know your bank's empty on that account, isn't it? You still need to have all these experiences and bodies of work or concerts you've done or recordings or something. I think they're just as important, aren't they?
Well, also because in the current climate, you know, with social media and reality shows, you know, people want to be famous, but maybe they don't know why they want to be famous, and they get to become famous. And I know a fair few famous people and rich people or whatever, and they're not all happy, you know. Whereas, you know, if you're doing something that your heart's in and you believe in it and you do it right, then hopefully, I know it sounds cheesy, but that's a kind of reward in itself, isn't it? And like you say, when you know, getting to the end of things, you want to say, well, I played on these albums, or I made this record, or I played on this film or this pop track or something, you know, like I've actually got something, you know.
Well, this would have been a really boring evening, wouldn't it, if you came in and said,
how much money I've got?
Yeah. Actually, yeah, exactly. You didn't have no experiences or any fun or anything.
Yeah.
A couple of questions here. Alec asks, strangest artist you've ever worked with?
Strangest. Well, there's no one that's like crazy out there, really, but there's people that are difficult to deal with, you know. And there's a lot of that, you know, maybe slightly less now because people aren't, there's sort of, the diva isn't sort of around so much, but there's definitely people that I've had conflict with, but maybe I'll speak to you about that in private rather than being negative. But just to say, the music industry is tough in that respect because there's a lot of people who don't get paid on time. You know, some people don't treat other people very well, and that is another challenge, you know, and that's not easy to sort of get through with some positivity. I know that doesn't answer your question really, but you know, just that is an answer.
Brilliant. Well, I think we're kind of wrapping up. I think we've got that's about it. I don't think there's any more questions coming through. So
Sure. Young guy who was asking about the studying trumpet, if I didn't answer that question, feel free to get in contact privately and I'll try and answer that a bit better. If you're unsure about what to do, I could maybe help with that a bit, you know.
Great. Yeah, so thanks very much, Graeme. Thanks for being my first guest on this strange but new experience for me. So
thank you.
Great.
Thanks for inviting me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, it was really insightful. And yeah, so next month I've got the legend that is Art Thiemann coming to talk about his long career in jazz and being a surgeon. So, do you know, I don't even know the date for that. Date's on our website. Maybe Janet will write it in the comments. But it's a Tuesday at the beginning of next month. thanks very much. Thanks, Graeme Flowers.
Thank you, mate. Thanks for inviting me.